And we look forward to a successful and wonderful journey led by our own professor, our own by adoption, Professor Kathy Taylor of Naugatuck Valley Community College. She teaches legal studies, and we are very honored to have her as our special guest for this second town hall series on Becoming Jim Crow, A Long Legal History. This is, as I mentioned, our second town hall where we will continue to share information and history of the Black people in America. And we really want to discuss race in America as it connects us all in the fabric as humanity and as one. And we are very honored during Women's History Month to have Professor Taylor join us in this very much needed conversation. So thank you once more. And before I turn it over to our presenter for the afternoon, I would like to introduce our own president, Dr. Daisy Coco de Filippis.
So hello, everybody. What an absolute joy it is to welcome you all, colleagues and students, to this afternoon presentation and continued discussion by the team that brought us the Black Agosto series, Professor Christopher Burrell, Director Diana Kramer, and the visit, and our dear visiting college colleague from MBCC, professor and co-founding chair of MBCC's Center for Racial Dialogue and Community Transformation, Kathy Taylor. It is fitting that International Women's Day continue today. I can't believe how wonderful it is that we're going to hear from Kathy today, and a very, really timely, thoughtful, necessary topic. So our very own phenomenal woman will tell us why we still continue to rise. And Maya Angelou will forgive me for all the allusions to her poetry as we engage in the topic of becoming Jim Crow, a long legal history. So what's in a name, you could say? You know, where does Jim Crow come from? Well, there was this performer, white performer, who would put on black a black face and created this minstrel performance in the early, in the 1830s. And this was designed to include music and body movement. And there was his act called Jump Jim Crow. And it was, this became a big hit across the United States, because in many, many ways, it served to create a caricature of Black humanity, or it served to dehumanize the oppressed, it served to control the image that was projected about the Black slave at that time. So I want to just quote a little bit from this wonderful book that was written by Eric Lott that is called Love and Blackface Minstrels and the American Working Class, where he explains that he writes, we put on not only blackface makeup, a slave dress that would imitate in his mind and white people's at the time, the dress and aspect and demeanor of the enslaved Black person. Over the years, the term Jim Crow was used, as Professor Taylor will discuss, to refer to a number of exclusionary, discriminatory, and racist practices designed to oppress Black communities and individuals and to justify it in the mind of many. Equal under the law still remains an aspirational goal in the United States. Please welcome with me our wonderful Professor Kathy Taylor.
Thank you so much for that, Dr. Daisy Coco de Filippis. I am excited to be here this afternoon working with Diana Kramer and Professor Burrell and Victor and Sol and Elizabeth and Brian. And of course, with you, President, has been quite a joy. Knowing the President as my mentor as well for more than a decade, she graciously connected me to so many of the others there at Hostos. And believe me, we had a lot of fun planning these events. And despite the fun we had, today, as I speak on our country's long legal history, it is not pretty, as the President just mentioned. There are times when we absolutely had a chance to get it right, and we completely missed the mark. And yet, this history is critically important to understanding today's challenges, how we arrived at this point, and our way forward, more importantly. And so we begin with a poll question. The past is dramatically shaped and influenced by, or the present rather, is dramatically shaped and influenced by the past. You can note if you strongly disagree. Disagree? Agree? Or strongly agree? And we can see the result on the page. I believe we have 10 more seconds. I am so glad when I look at these results that so many of you recognize that the past has shaped and influenced today. So often I hear, and I'm sure you may hear, oh, that was 50 years ago. Slavery ended over 150 years ago. Get over it. But this next quote from William Faulkner really does illustrate a powerful point, and one that I hope we will all remember. And here you have it. It's only 9 words. Faulkner, a writer who brilliantly portrayed the way that the South refused to accept its defeat, led to decay. But he was also a Southerner, a Mississippi man, whose private letters and public statements were riddled with the very racism that his books damned. In these 9 words, he acknowledged something that many Americans, even now, even after the summer of 2020, and its so-called racial awakening, failed to acknowledge. The past is never dead, and despite its ugliness, its brutality, its contradictions. We talk about it today, and we'll see ways that it is still very much with us today. And we begin in good old Virginia, the homeland of Thomas Jefferson, James Madison, George Washington, and Patrick Henry. Virginia claimed that from its earliest years, it singularly provided significant leadership for the colonies. In many ways, Virginia was a model of economic success as one of the first colonies. It played a major role in the American Revolution and in shaping the destiny of the new nation after 1776. Yet tragically, Virginia was also a leader in the gradual debasement of Blacks through its ultimate institutionalization of slavery. It pioneered a legal process that ensured Blacks a uniquely degraded status, one in which the cruelties of slavery and pervasive racial injustice was guaranteed by the laws. And unfortunately, just as the other colonies followed Virginia's leadership when it came to economics, many of them would also follow Virginia's leadership on slavery. In August 1619, a Dutchman ventured to Virginia and sold the colony 20 Africans. These first Africans who arrived in Jamestown a year before the Pilgrims landed at Plymouth Rock, that's significant, had not volunteered for the voyage. They were brought to America unwillingly, captives of Dutchmen who had apparently seized them from a Spanish ship to sell them to the labor-short colonists. Here in 1619, there was not yet a statutory process fixing the legal standing of Africans. And yet good old Virginia got right to clarifying the status of Blacks. And given Virginia's infamous role in the degradation of Black people, it is not by coincidence that in 2017, as the picture in the middle of the screen illustrates, the Unite the Right converged in Charlottesville, Virginia, home to the University of Virginia, founded by Thomas Jefferson. Let's remember, the African-American writer J. California Cooper reminds us, the future has a past, and understanding it is critically important to understanding our present challenges. Becoming Jim Crow, a long legal history, will analyze the history of anti-Black racism and its codification in the laws of the United States and even the colonies. The presentation will journey through our history, exploring the contradiction between our founding ideals of equality and freedom with the reality of human bondage and laws that squarely subjugated and marginalized people of African descent. Now, when I speak of codification, it's important to remember that codification is the process of arranging laws or rules around or according to a system or plan. In America and in Virginia, our laws were quickly organized around white supremacy and the dehumanization of Black people. From the early 17th century or 17th century, laws were being modified and even created to design a very racialized country. And one of the ways that we structure society is through our courts. Hence the title, All Roads Lead to Our Courts. In the law, there's a concept known as precedent. Precedent really is just an earlier case or controversy that is regarded as an example or guide to be considered in subsequent future similar circumstances or cases. So the best way to explain precedent, I am the youngest of three girls. I have two older sisters, Kimberly and Kelly. And as a teenager, I watched very closely what my parents allowed Kimberly and Kelly to do. Now, the reason why I'm watching what my parents allowed Kim and Kelly to do is because I was preparing to make the argument that since my parents allowed them to do it, I could also do it. And so I'm watching. Do you allow them to go to a concert? When do you allow them to drive? When do you allow them to stay out past 11 o'clock? Because if you allow Kimberly and Kelly to do that, well, guess what? Kathy should be able to do it too. And you see, that's what precedent means. Once my parents made a decision, my thinking was they would be bound by that decision when it came to me. So you see, precedent means that once a high court has decided an issue, all lower courts are bound by that decision, that holding. And so that precedent remains until the case is overturned. And just like parents don't like to be overturned and change their mind quite rapidly, courts also take some time to overturn themselves as well. And so what precedent does is it allows for stability and consistency. Unfortunately, when that precedent is wrong, it allows for injustice to reign throughout the country until that precedent is overturned. And that is where we begin. So here on this slide, where I'm specifically talking about perpetual enslavement, it is as early as 1640 when the courts start to get involved. And here we have the case of John Punch. And we see the courts in 1640, again, just 20 years after the Pilgrims. And we are not yet a country, but we are already organizing ourselves around perpetual enslavement. We are already making a distinction between people based on color. In this case, you can see we have three indentured servants, a Scot, an African, a Dutchman. They run away. They are quickly returned home to Jamestown, and they receive a sentence. And it's really important to note what happened here, because the Scot and the Dutchman, they were sentenced to an additional 4 years of labor. However, we have something interesting happening to the African, John Punch. For he was ordered to serve his master for his natural life. This case illustrates the beginnings of equating perpetual enslavement with people of African descent. Now here, 20 years later, we have the case of Elizabeth Key. And in this case, we have freedom won for Elizabeth Key. But her freedom brought lasting and devastating consequences on the heels of that victory. The case of Elizabeth Key really does shape the evolving law of slavery in the 17th century in Virginia. And so here we have Elizabeth Key, and she's making the argument that she should be free. As a child of an African mother and an English planter, she argued that her legal status was determined by the common law. That rule held that a father's status determined the status of his newborn child. That had long been the rule in England. So therefore, with Elizabeth's father being a free Englishman, she argued that she was also free. Additionally, she made another argument to the court. She said she's a baptized member of the Church of England, and as such, she cannot be held in slavery. The court agreed with her. When I found her case, I was thrilled. I wanted to shout for joy. Here we have 1660, and the court is agreeing and following the law. And so the court essentially rules that Elizabeth should no longer be an indentured servant, that her time is over. She is not to be perpetually enslaved. And the court ordered that not only would she be free, but she would receive an allowance of corn and clothing and receive compensation for the additional years of her service. Oh, what a day of rejoicing that must have been. A court ruled in her favor and she was freed. Unfortunately, this song of jubilee would not last. And so here, when we think of no good deed goes unpunished, the new laws were swift. In 1666, rather, the Virginia General Assembly changes the English common law. No longer will the father's status determine the child's status. Now the child's status will be determined by its mother. Moreover, an enslaved person's conversion to Christianity will not impact their servitude. With the stroke of the pen, these two laws prioritize the needs of Virginia tobacco planters for labor, which led to free labor and slave labor. And just like that, 17th century legislators and judges reversed ancient rules of English law for the benefit of slaveholders. And if we look at that last bullet there, we see that Elizabeth's case illustrates that the planters recognized what her freedom meant to them, and more importantly, their profit. Such greed brought about this shift from indentured servitude to lifelong slavery and now hereditary slavery. It really is a remarkable shift. And so this case illustrates that laws can absolutely be changed and modified to meet the needs of society. And so for those students in Professor Burrell's History 210 class, I didn't know this, he told me this, so he wanted to put you all on the spot, okay? But if you have any insights into the significance of these legal challenges, there is no pressure, you can unmute yourself, you can share what you think about these, the significance of these challenges, or I will give you an out, or you can wait until the Q&A. So I'll pause. And so now with Elizabeth Key and really this remarkable shift, the next thing we have here is a video. And this video again highlights the codification of slavery. And as you watch, I'm letting you know it's 9 minutes, so it's a little longer, so be a little more patient. It's longer than your average 30-second TikTok video, but bear with me, okay? Because what I want you to think about as you watch for these 9 minutes, and please feel free to turn your speakers up as well, but think about the many ways that slavery terrorized the enslaved person and also restricted the larger community around them.
The legal definition of what it was to be a slave, of who was a slave in American history, is both clear and ambiguous. In many instances, it was commonly understood that, as common law held, that enslaved people were property, owned as chattel, like livestock, and could be bought and sold as property. In more local instances, at the level of county or state governance, laws often stated clearly that slaves were people of African descent. Sometimes that language would be expressed ambiguously in terms of references to people's skin color or complexion or hair texture or facial features. And over the years, especially with forced sexual relations between slaveholding men and enslaved women, some of those categories about appearance, for example, would become harder to distinguish by the letter of the law. But nonetheless, the understanding was clear that anyone who was born to an enslaved woman was born as property, was born as a slave, regardless of appearance or paternal ancestry.
The law of slavery really evolved from the colonial era through the 19th century. It's beginning in the 1660s, where it really gets strongly codified in Virginia, where they make it explicit that Christianizing slaves doesn't affect their status. So it's saying that they're not enslaved based on being heathen. That doesn't matter. They can be Christians, but still enslaved. And then also makes it explicit that their children will also be enslaved. So slavery is not just a status for life, it's a perpetual hereditary status indefinitely. And so it's really from the 1660s to the early 1700s is where kind of that those elements of slavery are really codified in most states.
So the slave codes could differ from one region to the next, because indeed in the colonial times, each colony was able to make laws for itself. But one thing that was typical about the slave codes of the time is that the slave had no rights that would be recognized by any free person. A slave could not sue, a slave could not sit on a jury, a slave could not protect his own rights. And therefore, there was this obvious distinction between the rights that were recognized, not natural rights, mind you, just legal rights that were recognized for those who were free versus those who were not free. We see slave codes really coming into clear existence in the early national period, in the early 1800s. And the laws were designed to do a number of things. They were designed to strengthen slaveholders' property rights in the people they owned. So there were laws, for example, about capturing and returning self-liberated or escaped slaves, reaffirming the slaveholder's right to that property, even though, of course, that property was a person who sought to own himself or herself. Many of the slave codes were designed to add dimensions to individual slaveholders' control over enslaved people and to add a dimension of community control. So we might think here about laws that barred gatherings of enslaved people at night, right? Laws that dictated that enslaved people were not allowed to supervise their own gatherings, but could only gather under white people's supervision. Other kinds of laws restricted enslaved people's mobility, right? That decreed that enslaved people could not be on the roads during the daytime unless they had express written permission from their master. The so-called pass, in which a master would write a note saying, I give my slave permission to be on this road at this time for this work reason. In some places, cities and local municipalities would issue slave tags or slave passes for enslaved workers who worked as merchants or vendors or wagon drivers whose work required a fair amount of mobility. Other kinds of laws barred enslaved people from gaining access to education, made it a crime both to teach enslaved people, but also made it a crime for enslaved people to learn to read and write. And again, those kinds of laws were meant to create a social distance between free and enslaved people, and were meant to reinscribe slaveholders and slaveholding communities' right to control, to police, and to subordinate enslaved people. The laws regarding slaves gave the masters tremendous power for disciplining their own property. It was not absolutely unlimited. It was codified within the courts of law that a slave owner could not mutilate his slave, for instance, and certainly could not kill his own slave, at least not legally. But understand that even enforcing the laws, the minimal laws that would protect a slave, would require that a slave owner would be convicted by a judge and a jury of his own peers, which is white freemen. And therefore, even those small slivers of the law that were there to protect the slave often would not be enforceable. And therefore, in practice, a slave owner could often discipline as cruelly as wantonly as he wished.
One punishment that a number of abolitionists write about, slaveholders don't write about this, so it's possible abolitionists made this up, but they describe a practice known as catcalling, which is pretty awful. In that case, slaves will be tied to the ground, kind of posts where their hands are tied on one end, feet tied to the other end, stripped naked on their back, and then the person inflicting the punishment will take a cat, hold the cat by the back legs, put the cat on the person's back, and then drag them. And the cat, of course, will try to claw to get a grip and will basically rip up the slave's back. And the slaveholder will just continue to cat haul them repeatedly. And then afterwards pour salt and stuff in the wound. So the slaveholders come up with really kind of cruel, vindictive punishments. And obviously the point is not simply to punish that one slave, but really to terrify the others.
In the years after the revolution, there's a brief period of time where some slaveholders are troubled by the contradiction between revolutionary ideals and the principles of chattel slavery. And so there's this brief moment in the very late 1700s and early 1800s where some slaveholders move to manumit or free the people they own, usually in their wills. So a slaveholder might write in his will or her will that upon my death, these enslaved people that I own shall go free, shall gain their freedom. And in some unique instances, slaveholders might even bequeath a small piece of land or some livestock or other kinds of property to the enslaved people that they were manumitting. This moment of manumission, this post-revolutionary interest in bringing American social and economic life in line with revolutionary ideals, is short-lived. By the 1810s and certainly by the 1820s, most states, especially states in the Upper South, actually restrict individual slaveholders' rights to free their slaves in their wills, to manumit their slaves. But there is a sense that both economic chaos and social chaos will ensue if the nation includes free people of color, free African Americans as citizens, while other parts of the nation regard African Americans as slaves.
So the slave codes essentially provided slave owners with a protection that was sanctioned by the state, so that if their slave was damaged, ran away, or stolen, they could either be compensated or that slave would be returned to them. So this is a way that their property is preserved, sanctioned by law. And this is one of the first ways that racial slavery really becomes codified in the New World.
That is a difficult 9 minutes to watch and listen to. And I include that for one principal reason. Two, actually. One, for us not to forget the brutality of slavery. And the other reason, because in this video specifically, those who were speaking used two terms throughout the video. Sometimes they would say slave, other times they would say enslaved. And this is an important distinction because enslaved recognizes that there was a process that took place. It recognizes that something was done to a person, which means that something was done by someone. It's a way to hold us accountable. It does not assume that a person is just a thing, a slave. Instead, that focus, that emphasis on enslaved person reminds us of the humanity of the person and what was done to them. It is a very important distinction, and it makes quite a difference. Here, as mentioned in the video, we have Virginia quickly moving to establish slave codes. And remember I said, on the victory of Elizabeth Key, there were going to be long-lasting consequences. And that's what we have here. We have the General Assembly in 1662 saying, Elizabeth Key may be free, but we will never allow this to happen again. And then in 67, same thing. So much of the argument for slavery was, we are bringing people from Africa who are heathens. But if the conversion to Christianity now made someone not a heathen, then now we have to change the law. We have to change the rule. And so we can see these constant contradictions and the law trying to keep pace with what was happening, with what we espoused to be. And so here on the next slide, We have something very interesting with the General Assembly in September of 1668. And the General Assembly is essentially answering two questions. And the first question is, may an enslaved person who runs away be punished? Well, the answer is clearly yes. But here we have with moderate corporate punishment, for otherwise the runaway will explore an idle life. That was the thinking. The following year, however, the assembly pronounces something else. Now it is saying that the enslaved person only understands violence. And therefore, should an enslaved person happen to die during the course of punishment, that is okay. It is not going to be considered a felony. For after all, as the language here says, it must have been a mistake. Because for what man with premeditated malice would destroy his own property? These laws illustrate the speed at which Virginia passed slave codes, codifying Black segregation and white supremacy and control. And at least the notion that a white person could do whatever they wish to another human being so long as the law classified that person as their property. Next, we have another law in 1618. And this law is specifically aimed at preventing Negro insurrections. Look at the language of the law. You may see some similarities between the current practice of stop and frisk. As greed extended the brutality of enslavement, suspicion of planned revolts led to laws further restricting African movement. Laws stripped Africans of the right of self-defense. The movements were under watch. And in order to leave the watchful eye of the overseer or owner, Africans needed a certificate or pass. So as you read it, let's notice what exactly is being restricted. Now think of stop and frisk. Aggressive patrolling found to be in violation of our constitutional rights, in which officers are encouraged routinely to stop and question persons on the street who are unknown to them, who are suspicious, or whose purpose for being abroad is not readily evident. The language is very, very similar. Through our courts, police were given the power to stop a person based on reasonable suspicion. But inherent in that is what makes a person suspicious. And so through the policy of stop and frisk, what we have is reasonable suspicion morphing into stopping any person for any reason. You can see the beginnings of the policy in this 1618 Act 10. And according to the New York ACLU 2019 report, an analysis revealed that innocent New Yorkers have been subjected to police stops and street interrogations more than 5 million times since 2002, and that the Black and Latino Hispanic communities continue to be the overwhelming targets of these tactics. At the height of stop and frisk in 2011, over 685,000 people were stopped. Here's an important note, and you all probably have heard this. Nearly 9 out of 10 stopped and frisked New Yorkers were completely innocent. Here in 1680, we have the beginning of a policy of stopping people of color for being suspicious. despite all of these cases and the slave codes, it is now in 1703 when the Virginia Assembly finally codified servants brought to this country who were not Christians in their native country, and the classification is slaves. All such Negro, mulatto, and Indian slaves are real property. The status of Blacks in Virginia drastically changed over the last century of the 17th century. Gone are the days now of John Punch and serving as an indentured servant, and gone are his hopes of freedom. The Black indentured servant was increasingly becoming replaced by the enslaved person of African descent. In 1705, the Virginia General Assembly removed any lingering uncertainty about this terrible transformation. It made a declaration that would seal the fate of African Americans for generations to come. And so from this slide to the next, I actually skip 150 years, because now this is the law of the land. Here, on March 6, 1857, we're not too far off from that date of March 6th, we're 3 days away. Here we have the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, and it issues what is widely regarded as one of the worst Supreme Court opinions ever. The question before the court was whether African Americans are citizens of the United States and thus able to file suit in federal court. His analysis of this issue is couched in clearly racist language. And I'm sure you've read the language. What immediately jumps out at me is they, African slaves, are so far inferior that they had no rights which the white man was bound to respect. Moreover, the Negro is justly and lawfully reduced to slavery, treated as an ordinary article of merchandise for his own benefit. And here, the Chief Justice is not yet finished. Take a minute to read his words, memorialized in a decision by our very own Supreme Court of the United States. Here, he is saying something very interesting. He is saying that our great framers of our Constitution, the founding fathers, were brilliant, honorable, and learned men who understood language. He's saying that when they wrote these words, we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their creator with certain inalienable rights, chief among them life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. He recognizes the contradiction in light of slavery. And given that cognitive dissonance, that discomfort that comes from having a belief challenged by one's actions, that cognitive dissonance could not stand. He has to rationalize it away. Therefore, the Chief Justice argues this. He says that those wonderful words that we read about, they were never intended to apply to the unhappy Black race, his words. Instead, everyone understood that the Negro was mere property. As you may imagine, the response to this opinion was immediate. Rather than settle the issue of slavery, it simply inflamed public opinion and divided the country further. Frederick Douglass attacked the opinion. And in his attack, Frederick Douglass noted that the rights of African Americans derive not from any judicial pronouncement, but from natural law. Douglass wrote, "We are now told that the day is lost, all lost, and that we might as well give up the struggle. The highest authority has spoken. The voice of the Supreme Court has gone out over the troubled waters of the country saying, peace, be still. The Supreme Court of the United States," Douglass said, "is not the only power in the world. It is very great, but the Supreme Court of the Almighty is greater." And this becomes precedent. That binding authority on the issue of slavery. With the court having spoken on the issue of slavery, the Civil War is just around the corner, beginning in South Carolina in 1861. After the war, we have the 13th Amendment passed by Congress and ratified on December 6, 1865. Remember that date. That brought about the abolition of slavery. The most immediate impact of the 13th Amendment was to end slavery as it was practiced in the United States. The amendment also bars involuntary servitude. But look at what it does here. The amendment does allow a person convicted of a crime to be forced to work. So we can see, even in our beloved Constitution and our 13th Amendment, many prison labor practices and chain gangs do not run afoul of the 13th Amendment. Now, if we look down at the bottom there at the 14th Amendment, it's ratified 2 years later in 1868. And it says it grants citizenship to all persons born in the United States, including formerly enslaved persons, and provided citizens with equal protection under the law. Finally, the 14th Amendment granted Congress the power to enforce this amendment, a provision that has led to the passage of other landmark legislation, including the Civil Rights Act of 1964 and the Voting Rights Act of 1965 that could use a little help, particularly now in 2021. Interestingly, though, we see another way that the past is not dead. When we talk about immigration and citizenship, you may hear calls to end birthright citizenship. The argument goes, people are just coming here so they can have babies, and those babies should not be American citizens. That's the argument we hear even now. Well, this birthright citizenship, the fact that birth in the United States confers citizenship, is a direct result of the Civil War and grows out of our 14th Amendment. This newly freed population needed a legal status. They were in limbo. They weren't enslaved. Until we have the 14th Amendment, they're not citizens. And so the 14th Amendment remains critically important today. It is the most litigated amendment in our Constitution. Not the first, not the second. It is the 14th Amendment and the equal protection of the laws. So when you hear arguments objecting to birthright citizenship, know that this citizenship was conferred on the backs of Blacks, and the need to codify their legal status in this country as a result of the end of slavery with the 13th Amendment. And so after these amendments, it's wonderful when you read the language. You think about, we really do have a chance to change. There were over 600,000 thousand people who died in the Civil War, we have another shot. Despite not living up to the ideals of the Declaration of Independence, with its promise that all men are created equal, or the revolutionary ideals memorialized in our constitutional language of we the people, in order to form a more perfect union, establish justice, and secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves, do ordain and establish this Constitution for the United States of America, we have another chance to get it right. We have a real opportunity to extend the dignity afforded by our Constitution to the newly freed population. Unfortunately, any such hope would be short-lived. In the next video, this video really does detail how we failed to live up to the promises of the 13th and 14th Amendment, and this video is just shy of 3 minutes.
Between emancipation and 1874, this is a period of a great deal of violence, uncertainty, and conflict in the South. There's no other way to describe. We call it the Reconstruction era, but really at a local level, this is all about conflicts over independence and equality between Blacks and whites. And the legal system plays an important role in this. The Black codes were taken from the old slave codes, and these were laws that were meant to apply solely to Black people. And they were laws that made it a crime, again, to be out after a certain hour for possessing a weapon of any kind. Vagrancy was one. Let's say you had a skill as a slave. You wanted to be a barber, or you wanted to have your own shop, or you want, even if a Black woman wanted to be a laundress, you had to have a permit, and you had to pay money to get that permit. And if you were operating without a permit, you could be arrested under the Black codes. These laws vary from state to state, but they all had the same purpose, which was to subject the free people to their own particular kinds of control. You have people being arrested on charges from the Black codes and put to work on the streets. And this is before the big convict leasing system emerges. These are all local laws. If you're arrested for vagrancy, if you're arrested for theft, if you're arrested for larceny, these are tried in local courts. These are not tried in federal courts. These are tried in local courts. There is actually very little that the federal government can do to intervene in these kinds of situations. That this was really a tool that was used to keep Blacks in fear and also to curtail their independence. It's very common in newspapers, local county newspapers, for the press to describe the who is in the local jail. And they'll say 73 in the Dallas County Jail, all Negro. So many people arrested for theft, all Negro. Now, these were meant to convey an idea that former slaves were inherently criminal. But what they really show is that whites didn't have to worry about the power of the law when it came to their behavior. It's inevitable that with the combination of the legacy of slavery and the power placed in the hands of whites, these laws are going to be disproportionately used against Black people. And they were.
Look at that date. March 17th, 1866. Let's not just gloss over it. It is a year after slavery was abolished. Remember, the 13th Amendment was ratified on December 6th, 1865. Just 3 months later, we have the Georgia legislature passing one of the first Black codes, new laws that were uniformly applied to Black citizens and subjected them to criminal prosecution for offenses such as loitering or breaking curfew or vagrancy or having a weapon or not carrying proof of employment. They were specifically crafted to ensnare Black people and return them to chains. And these laws were effective. For the first time in US history, many state penal systems held more Black prisoners than white, all of whom could be leased for profit. Once again, African American men, women, and children were arrested under these statutes. Because imagine, once a mother is arrested for being idle or loitering, now her child is also subject, because now that child could be a vagrant. It has no one to take care of it. And so when we think about these laws, being able to be in prison for gambling or drunkenness or staying out past curfew, they are reminiscent of slave catchers. Now, law enforcement officers could seek out Blacks walking alone and arrest them on fabricated charges without an attorney and on the word of any white person. A conviction soon followed. And then the warden leased out the inmates' labor for profit. What we see here is the loophole in the 13th Amendment, which allows for this practice to continue. Here, 30 years after those first Black codes, we have Plessy v. Ferguson, a very famous case, another case of our Supreme Court, whereby it ushers in the doctrine of separate but equal. Here we have Percy, or Plessy rather, an octoroon, meaning that he is 1/8 Black. He boards a white-only train. He refused to move to the colored section, and he argues that he was being denied his 14th Amendment rights and equal protection of the laws. The court was not convinced. Instead, the court found that so long as accommodations were separate and equal, there was no 14th Amendment violation. In fact, the court argued that the 14th Amendment could not have been intended to abolish distinctions based upon color or to enforce social equality. Now we all know the fallacy, or the fallacy rather, in this case, as we have seen pictures of segregated water fountains. We have seen pictures of segregated schools. The facilities were never equal. Public venues such as water fountains and restrooms and bus waiting rooms and movie theaters and swimming pools. There's a long history about swimming pools and segregation. And public schools were all segregated. Private restaurants, restrooms, hospitals, churches, libraries, school books, waiting rooms, housing, prisons, even cemeteries. Not quite sure what that means, that we would take time to segregate cemeteries, but cemeteries too were segregated. And when there were colored facilities, they were older, poorly maintained, and less resourced, even when there was a facility available. Now think about 2021. Think about school funding. What schools are well-financed, resourced, maintained? Remember, the past does not die. Demos has a really interesting report that looks at how public education used to be seen as a public right. And as public education became Blacker and browner, the view of education being a public right and worthy of public investment started to wither. The support for public education started to wither away. So really, despite this fallacy of Plessy v. Ferguson, it remained good law. In fact, it was precedent for 58 years until Brown versus Board of Education. And it was not until 1954 that the Supreme Court declares that separate is inherently unequal. Within that 58-year period of separate but equal, we have the establishment of Jim Crow. As the president mentioned, and the origin of Jim Crow with the minstrel shows, Jim Crow went well beyond voting and segregated schools and transportation. Jim Crow was a regime that dehumanized Blacks over and over again. Look at these laws here. Can't play checkers or dominoes together. When we walk through Bryan Park and before the pandemic and we would see people playing together, that would not happen. You can't fish together. There's no amateur baseball clubs, can't play baseball together. And this one particularly takes me back. As my grandfather played in the Negro Leagues, the Philadelphia Stars, Jim Crow provided a constant reminder of who was in charge. And because this was precedent, it remained with us. And yet it was still challenged several times over. Here we have the Rice case from 1927, and we get a clear glimpse into the reasoning of the Supreme Court and how it would address the separate but equal doctrine as it was tested in the courts. In this case, the court addressed the issue and the Mississippi restructuring of schools for colored or white children. In this case, Martha, a Chinese American young girl, she did not have Negro blood as acknowledged by the court, but neither was she considered white. Therefore, the district court ruled that she could attend a colored school. Mississippi separate school law, the court explained, was enacted to prevent race mixing. So here we have the court saying, to throw the Chinese American girl into the colored school. Why? Because according to the court, the law was intended to serve the broad, dominant purpose of preserving the purity and integrity of the white race. The family appeals to the United States Supreme Court. The Supreme Court rules that yes, Martha is a citizen. They ruled that she was not being denied her 14th Amendment rights to equal protection. And they cited Plessy and a whole series of other cases, other precedent. And they upheld the constitutionality of school segregation. What's important in this case is the explicit language used by the court. They said that this law of segregated education was to serve the broad dominant purpose of preserving the purity and integrity of the white race. And we know that where one goes to school, even now, is largely determined on where one lives. And so next, we turn to housing. Now remember that language. The broad dominant purpose of preserving the purity and integrity of the white race. Let's move into the 1930s. In order to purchase a house in America prior to that time, you would have to pay 50% of the sales price up front. The new terms, however, would be 10 to 20% down, and the bank would finance the 80 or 90% of it. And they would not finance it over 5 years, but they would finance it over 30 years. These are still the provisions that we have even now. And this opened up opportunities for millions to own homes. Here we have the Federal Housing Administration issuing long-term low mortgage loans. But guess what? It did so in a way that would racialize housing, wealth, and opportunity for decades in ways that are still with us. Remember, we started with the past is never dead. When lawmakers began drafting the GI Bill in 1944, some Southern Democrats feared that returning Black veterans would use public sympathy for veterans to advocate against Jim Crow. You may remember the signs, "Ain't I a Man?" To make sure the GI Bill largely benefited white people, Southern Democrats drew on tactics that they previously used to ensure that the New Deal would help as few Black people as possible. Roosevelt signs the Readjustment Act in 1944, and it ushers in sweeping benefits for veterans, including college tuition, low-cost home loans, and unemployment insurance. Unfortunately, we had another chance to make a change, and we failed. As the years went on, white veterans flowed into newly created suburbs where they began amassing wealth in skilled positions. But Black veterans lacked this opportunity. So we have white people moving into suburbs and Blacks largely being excluded. But how did this happen? Well, remember the language of the Rice case. The broad dominant purpose of preserving the purity and integrity of the white race. So here we have the Federal Housing Administration adopting a principle that an integrated neighborhood is a bad risk. It's a financial risk. An integrated neighborhood is an unstable neighborhood. As a consequence, most of the mortgages went to suburbanizing America in a very racialized way. So we have redlining. You can see the map here. It's a decades-old practice of marking the map by race to say where we're going to lend money and provide insurance and where are we going to freeze out. Here in 1947, only two of the more than 3,200 Veteran Administration guaranteed loans in 13 Mississippi towns went to Black homeowners or borrowers. But oftentimes, sometimes we only want to look at the South and say, look at what they did. But in New York and the northern New Jersey suburbs, fewer than 100 of the 67,000 mortgages insured by the GI Bill was supported by non-whites. Here on this map, we see Brooklyn. The appraiser went into Brooklyn in the 1930s, went to assess Bed-Stuy, and essentially said the homes are in poor upkeep. There are clerks, there's laborers, there's merchants living here, 30% of them foreign-born Jews and Irish mostly. And then the colored infiltration is an adverse influence on neighborhood desirability. And so everywhere where you see marked red, that is a D. That is the worst grade possible, saying that it is hazardous to underwrite mortgages here. So we go from green, just little section of green there in that left-hand corner. Then we go to blue, which is still desirable, but we have green, which is best, blue, which is desirable. We have yellow, which is declining, and red, which is completely hazardous. So here again, the interesting thing about this is when you look at these maps that were redlined in the 30s and 40s, you can sometimes overlay a map from the 1990s, from 2000, from 2021, where we are now. And you can see some of these same neighborhoods are still blighted and have a lack of investment. So let's see if this poll question works, okay? So in a poll question, what percent went to non-whites, okay? What percent? So we have the figure here. It's 120 million or 120 billion rather with a B, not an M. Would you say 2%? So far, 2% is winning. We have 5% as well. We have some saying 12%. Another saying 25%. And what we have here, it is actually 2%. So 2% of that 120 billion went to non-whites. And why does this matter? Let's explore that. If I'm a returning veteran from World War II in 1947, and I'm able to buy a house in Levittown, New York, let's take a guess at how much that new home, with its new dishwasher and refrigerator and oven, let's estimate what the price was then in 1947. And in a new poll question, let's think about what that house is now worth in 2021. Thank you. And this one is pretty split. So it's interesting. 35% have said a 1947 value of $12,000 and now a 2021 value of $614,000, so that's 41%, followed by a current value of $491,000, then followed by a current value of $256,000, and lastly, the value of $364,000. Well, this is important because the net worth of that home now is $491,000. Okay, it's C. So here, the 1947 value was $6,990. That new value is $491,000. That's wealth. That's equity in one's home. That's money for the next generation to attend college, to start a business. So when we hear about this wealth gap of 2021, we know that the past is still very much with us. And I want to just address this really quickly. What is left out of this bootstrap myth that so many Americans share and talk about their access to opportunities that have been closed to non-whites? So Roosevelt's New Deal offered many Americans a path out of poverty. But there's a different narrative that we often tell ourselves. And it is the narrative of we came here with nothing. We worked hard. We pulled ourselves up by our bootstraps. And it is often, this bootstrap argument is often offered to point the finger, to say, we did it. Why can't you do it? What is left out of this story, of the American dream, of our meritocracy, is the very long history of anti-Black legislation that robbed Black people of boots. And so here we come to two quotes, by one by Dr. King and one by James Baldwin. And they relate to the lie that we tell ourselves about America. Ultimately, what we do with facts, it matters. It informs the questions that we ask. It informs the strategies that we come up with to solve a problem. We have to have an honest confrontation with the past. And it has everything to do with how we move forward and how we understand the challenges and how we arrived at this point. I love this picture. It makes me happy. And I thought I needed to include this because some of you may be feeling mighty down after this presentation. And I tell you, I started with this history is not pretty. In fact, it is quite ugly. And yet, Nicole Hannah Jones, she reminds us in her 1619 New York Times series that our democracy's founding ideals were false when they were written. Black Americans have fought to make them true. And we see glimpses for hope. And yes, cause for concern. Yet it is always Black activists and artists calling us to hope, serving as the great conscience of our country. As I close, I want to take a moment to listen to the soulful and powerful singer and activist Nina Simone. We have taken a very sober look at the past, and we see its ripples throughout our present America, our current challenges, our tensions, our constant drive to do better, to be better, to live up to our highest ideals and our noblest aspirations. Nina Simone captures both the push to get us there and the fierce urgency of why it is so important. I hope you all enjoy the beauty of her voice and the power in her plea. Challenges to make America more equitable and more just. This song gives me hope, and I hope its purity of message and the power of its lyrics leave you with a sense of hope. And I am pleased to answer any questions or hear any comments. And I thank you all for staying with us this afternoon.
Thank you so much, Professor. Everyone, if you can please use your reactions and emojis to give Professor Taylor a huge round of applause, a standing ovation if you wish from behind your screens, a thumbs up, some clapping. Let's all join in together to thank her for this tremendous presentation on this wonderful sunny Tuesday afternoon. Thank you so much. I join you, Professor Varell, indeed. I can speak for myself. I know I learned a great deal of new information, so thank you so much. As the professor mentioned, if you have any questions, please raise your hand or send us an emoji at this time so that we can allow you to unmute. and ask any questions you like of Professor Taylor and her presentation today. Teresa, go ahead.
Oh, thank you. Thank you so much. Professor Taylor, I just want to thank you out loud for the breathtaking research and information. I too learned a lot this afternoon. I'd like to know what led you to this research and maybe a little bit even about the process that you underwent to find like all of this legal information.
Well, you know, thank you for that question, Teresa. Part of the reason why I do this work is because I also talk about equity and inclusion in the school system. And when I think about equity and how many systemic inequities there are and structural barriers for so many people, and there is a lack of understanding. Oftentimes, we look to blame individuals. But it really does take an awareness and an understanding of how these policies are still with us, right? So when someone says, if I'm in a workshop, well, Kathy, you know, that was 50 years ago, that was 120 years ago, that was, you know, fill in the blank. Well, having how one law serves to reinforce another law and how laws build upon each other and how those practices are still with us. So Teresa, I teach real estate law as well. And I know one of the things that I went to a historically Black college, Hampton University in Virginia, and I know what those professors did for me. And I try to replicate that in the classroom. And I tell my students that I just don't want them to memorize, but I want them to understand and be able to connect things at a very, very high level. And so when we look at, oh, Teresa's daughter went to Hampton, I see that in the chat. So when I think about redlining, or if I'm teaching about restrictive covenants that said that Mexicans or the language would be Jews or Blacks would not be able to live in these neighborhoods. Even though that was abolished by the court, that practice is still with us. Because if one person is able, if a white veteran is able to secure a home in the 40s that is now worth $500,000, that wealth is still with that family. And the lack of wealth is still with the other family. Right. And so this is all with us. And so it is one of the benefits of being a professor that we just keep learning. And one of the things that I recognize that even I did not know about Elizabeth Key. And I think that her story is really, really, it really illustrates a point that we did have the capacity to follow the laws. And greed and profit certainly got in the way. So thank you for that, Teresa. And I see Eric with a hand.
Hi, yes, thank you, Kathy, for this wonderful presentation today. I'm just curious, having learned so much just now about the history, what do you think is the future? Where do we go from here as a society?
You know, Eric, I wish I had the answer to that. But one of the things that I absolutely believe and know is, and I see Chris laughing. I think we said if we knew the answer to that, we would be able to retire, right? But part of the challenge is knowing that history. And not only knowing that history, but being able to see it being repeated and having a strategy in place. Some of the things that we're seeing today is quite predictable. If anyone is watching about the voting restrictions that are being put in place in Georgia, that's all predictable. And we've seen this playbook again. Actually, a very wise woman who is on the call, I'm not going to name her, but I remember her telling me many years ago, Kathy, listen to the note. The note repeats. And that's what we see here. We see a repeating of the note. And so you have different groups organizing in Georgia to look at, to mobilize people to challenge these laws. And I'm glad that's happening in Georgia, but the same thing is happening in Pennsylvania quietly. And so sometimes we often give the North a pass. The Brennan Law Center does something phenomenal. They track voting rights. And particularly when we see shifting demographics, you see that the legislatures will put more restrictive voting practices in place. So one, my thing is, and smarter people can figure out how we move forward. But part of how we move forward is making sure that we tell the right story. Because when we address it from a systems and structural issue, then that's very different from dealing with it on the individual personal level. It requires different strategies to employ.
Sandy Figueroa, recent retiree, after 44 years at Hostos. you were excellent. I've done a lot of reading, and everything that you said, obviously, I could understand and relate to. What really bothers me is that the education of our people in the schools, and to think that the New York City school system is the most segregated school system in the entire country. So you are totally right when you say that we give the North a pass when we're right here in the den of iniquity in New York. I also live on Long Island, and I've lived on Long Island for as long as I've been teaching at Hostos. And I'm a city kid. I was born in the Bronx, in Spanish Harlem, and raised in the Bronx. And my husband and I moved out here. And I could see that as soon as we moved in, cross burnings, all of that stuff, the redlining was very, very clear. Everything was clear. And all of what people think of Long Island as being white enclaves no longer exists. So looking at this and having our young people learning a falsified history, a dream world, almost like Walt Disney, is how do we get our people to come together, to mobilize and say, we've had enough of this. And some of the politicians who look like us in our communities are the biggest sellouts. That's an old 1960s word, but it still means the same thing. It's really frustrating to see, you know, and at 74 years of age, as you said, the same note. Michelle Alexander says the same thing. People want to stay in power. They're not going to give it up that easily. So I appreciate your teaching us what should be taught from grade one all the way up to grade two. How do we mobilize?
You know, Sandy, that is a wonderful question. And Diana put in the comments something I should have added, it matches also with your comment. Or question regarding, we should talk to our, Diana used the word liberal friends, right? Dr. King, in his last manuscript, Where Do We Go From Here, Chaos or Community? Dr. King talked a lot about liberal whites in terms of the willingness to look at down south as, you know, oh, that's terrible, the dogs, all of that. But when he came up to Chicago, he found something very different, something that he didn't quite recognize. And so the reality of and you make an excellent point in terms of not only is it important to vote, but who we vote for, but also running for office and holding people accountable and not necessarily just assuming that someone who has a D behind their name is automatically working in our favor. Sandy, you mentioned New York being segregated. I live in Waterbury, which is the most isolated district in the country. It was featured in The Atlantic. And when you think about it, we are surrounded by wealthy white suburbs. And so now there is a whole school funding formula. So long as we continue to fund schools based off of property taxes, because we know those property taxes and the prices are racialized because of redlining. We already know that. So if we keep that system in place, we know we are perpetuating this inequality where teachers in the cities are earning less and may not have all the resources that they need as well. And so here in Connecticut, there is a mobilization around that school funding. My husband is an architect and works in affordable housing. That's another area. Because if you can control housing, you control schools. And so actually penalizing communities. We have laws on the book now, on the books now that requires a certain amount of the town to have affordable housing. Unfortunately, they are not enforced. And so just enforcing the laws that we have and changing the ones that need to be changed. And I can think of none better than affordable housing and education funding.
Hello. Hi, thank you for your knowledge. You've been wonderful. I mean, I really feel more that I learned more today than in the past. I do have a question. Many powerful ills blackface. Were there any facts that back it besides just to be racist?
Wait, say that again. I didn't miss the last point. I missed were the there, point.
Were there any facts that back it besides just to be racist?
Just to be racist in terms of what? Back what?
Many powerful ills blackface.
Oh, in terms of blackface, and so what the president mentioned. Well, so much is how we talk about a people, how we think about a people, how we depict people, and the narrative around those people. Because the narrative will inform how we treat people. And so Coates, in his book, Between the World and Me, he speaks of, and I'm gonna try to get this quote correct. But it is somewhere along the lines of race is the child of racism, not the father. Okay? Race is the child of racism, not the father. And so we see that here we have these racist and oppressive actions. And that is even what gives us race, because before so much was geography. Where are you from? Okay. And then we have the creation of race to justify races and oppressive systems. And so that depiction of the happy slave dancing, right? It exonerates the slave owner. That's what it does. It says, you know what? They were happy, they were well cared for, they were well fed, and they were thrilled that you took care of them. Look what a good person you are, right? In the video, she specifically talked about the newspaper and the newspaper sharing the story of 20 Negroes arrested today, right? It creates an impression. If you think even now, it creates an impression. So sometimes when I'm watching the news with my kids and I will see a black face on the news, I will say to them, let's count the seconds. How long does that face stay there? I want to change the narrative. I don't want my children to absorb the messaging that black and criminality, it goes together, right? And so in the newspaper, the same thing. Where is the placement for crimes committed by Blacks and Hispanics versus white? We see this. That's not my area, so I only, you know, can only touch the surface of it. But all of these things matter. If we think about how we describe people, after the Capitol, there was a whole argument on what we should call people who raided the Capitol, who wanted to attack democracy. And people were saying, well, you can't call them insurrectionists. Well, I would imagine that if they were Black or if they had Muslim garb on, there would not have been an argument as to what to call them. And so thinking about that narrative is really important, and fighting against that narrative. And so recognizing it when we hear it, when we hear people refer to people as thugs, pushing back, well, why did you use that word then? But yet when people are celebrating their team winning, you know, they're just overzealous fans. Well, that creates an image. In New Orleans with Hurricane Katrina, if you're calling people looters versus calling people trying to survive, well, that's a difference, right? And how we label things, it matters. So I would argue, yes, I can't think of any other intent that it would serve other than to provide a narrative of this very happy slave and look at what good people you were to enslave them. There's a question also in the chat. I want to say it's a Mr. Terrence Brown. How would you suggest we get local government officials and the legislature to promote an equitable balance of affordable housing with the need for community investment by local residents, whereby housing is being erected as rentals in lieu of condominiums or co-ops? Actually holding legislators accountable, going to their town halls, organizing phone drives, banks, bombarding them with emails. So few people get involved in that process. And so organizing an effort to address and attack and be very specific, right? We need to know the law that we want to be replaced. We need to know the law that we want to see enforced, because that's the easier call. We already have the law. Let's try reinforcing it, or enforcing it rather, right? And so thinking about showing up at those town halls, writing those letters, and having a very organized campaign to get attention. It's one of those things where it's quite possible that the squeaky wheel can get the oil. If you look at what was done in Georgia with Stacey Abrams and Black Voters Matter, they were organized. They weren't necessarily always on the television, but they had a grassroots organization, and that works. And so I am always encouraged that language of we the people, for the people, by the people, we are the people. We have to own that and demand something different. Diana?
We have another question from Pat Mabry. She asks, well, she states first, thank you for playing Nina Simone. And her question is, what current day artists would you suggest the younger generation can listen to, which can uplift and create hope?
Oh my goodness, now I'm going to sound my age, because so much of this current music, I don't know about, it's questionable. But I will tell you, I really like the old artists. I like Nina Simone, and I particularly like Sam Cooke. And I also like John Legend and Common and The Roots, and even, you know, Public Enemy. And right there from New York, I still listen to Boogie Down Productions, because it was a period, particularly if we're thinking about rap music, where it was about Black empowerment. And currently, right now, that seems to be wanting in a lot of the music. So I still like certainly the old school. Yes, I am telling my age with Boogie Down Productions. But the gray hair also does that.
And thank Professor Taylor once more for her incredible and powerful presentation today. And invite all of you to join us for our next one on April 14th, same time, same place, same Zoom link, 3 p.m. and join us as we have our final conversation on being Black and medicine and how it has affected the history of a people from the 50s and up until now during COVID. So please take care, have a wonderful rest of your afternoon, and see you April 14th. Thank you.
Newborn to Jesus.